Well, thank you very much. My name is Jelena Sjakste. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me here. And this talk is not going to be about development. It is not going to be about Abinit. It is just going to be about interpretation of some experiments about hot electron relaxation and how theory can help this interpret these experiments. And I'm going to talk about ultrafast dynamics of hot carriers and about electron phonon coupling. This work was done in collaboration with Natalie Vast from our lab. Some part of it has been done by Raja Sen, who is our new postdoc. We collaborate with the group of Professor Luca Perfetti from also our laboratory, who performs ARPAS and two photon for the emission experiments. And also we collaborated with the group of Professor Katsumi Tanimura in Osaka in Japan, who is also doing ARPAS and two photon for the emission experiments. The outline of my talk is the following. First, I'm going to introduce electron phonon scattering as applied to highly excited electrons. Then I will present our results on highly excited electron relaxation in silicon and in indium selenide. So let us start. So here I show the typical band structure of a semiconductor. The case is gallium arsenide. Let us say we excited an electron, for example, with a laser, above the second or even the third minimum of the conduction band. This is what I would call highly excited. And in that case, the main electron phonon scattering channel for this electron will be intervalley electron phonon scattering. So scattering with short wavelength phonon with large Q vector, even in the case when the semiconductor is a polar one. The experiments which allow to follow the dynamics of this excitation of highly excited electrons are mostly the ARPAS ones, so angle and time resolved photoemission experiments. Usually you have two laser pulses. One is the excitation and the second one is a probe. And because the delay between the pump and the probe can be varied, you can follow the dynamics of electrons. For example, here, this is the case of gallium arsenide from this work. You see the electrons excited into the gamma valley. And then at a time a little bit after, you can see that these electrons have lost some of the energy and some of them have transferred to another valley. In those experiments, it was possible to identify two very distinct relaxation regimes, which are related to electron phonon coupling, both of them. So you see here on this intensity maps that first electrons, the intensity goes down very quickly. This is the very fast relaxation, initial one. And then there is a slower regime. And what is interesting is that the slower regime is the same for the gamma and for the L valleys. This is for the case of gallium arsenide. So we were able to interpret these experiments. It has been some years ago. And so the very first short relaxation time is related to spread of the initial the electron, which is excited into some initial part of the Brillouin zone, is distributed over all the Brillouin zone. I have also heard a word isomerization in one of the previous talks, one of the previous days. So this is it. We called it hot electron ensemble. So the electron which is spread over the Brillouin zone, it's intervalley transitions which are mainly responsible for this process. It is very fast. And the second one is the second stage of relaxation is the loss of energy by this hot electron ensemble. So, and this is the longer relaxation times. So you see lines here, the lines are not a fit. The lines are initial calculations by standard state-of-the-art methods, which are the density functional perturbation theory plus 1 year interpolation and plus the correction for polar component in the case of polar material. So these are, this has been some time ago. Now I would like to present the new results. First about highly excited electron relaxation in silicon. So in the case of silicon, the electrons were excited over a very large energy interval between 1 and 3 eV above the bottom of the conduction band. And the reason why these experiments were performed is because there was a controversy. And the controversy was related to this previous work in 2011, when already some of the relaxation times of hot electrons in silicon were measured by the same group. However, they were found about 10 times longer than the ones calculated by DFPT. So it seemed to be a controversy. I will not come back to all the possible explanations which were proposed. They can be found in this paper. But finally, the explanations which we came up with is that actually DFPT predicts correctly very, very short initial relaxation times of a few femtoseconds, which are simply not measurable by those experiments. And the ones which can be measured, the lifetimes which can be measured, are all related to the energy loss. The initial relaxation, you just cannot see it. And if this hypothesis is adapted, then we could get reasonable agreement between theory and experiment. So that could be the end of the story, but it's not the end of the story. I just wanted to say also that, okay, these were the relaxation times, but actually what we calculate is the relaxation rate, the rate of energy transfer from electrons to phonons. As you can see here, it follows the shape of the DOS, of the electronic DOS. So the transition probability, exactly as for the total scattering rate, is determined by the shape of the DOS. Even some peaks and some can be reproduced experimentally. You see that this dip is related to this peak in the relaxation time. And so it's electron interval scattering which is responsible for this process. And then just a few more words. Although electron phonon coupling in silicon has been studied very, very well, and it would seem that no more controversies are possible, there are still some. For example, in this work, a question was raised whether hot electrons in silicon lose energy to optical or to acoustical phonons. So the question is, in silicon, electrons lose energy mostly to optical phonons, truth or myth? So as we had the data, we decided to see what DFT can answer to this question. Of course, if you calculate the total scattering rate, so the initial scattering, you get at 300K that acoustical phonons are dominant. And so you would answer that the answer is the myth. However, if you calculate the energy loss rate, then it's optical phonons which dominate. And so actually the answer is truth, at least from the DFT point of view. It is the energy in silicon is transferred mostly to optical phonons. And it is not completely unexpected. There are several works in the past, even old ones, which predicted it to be like this. Total electron phonon scattering rate is dominated by acoustical phonons, but energy scattering is dominated by optical phonons. And why is it like this? Why there is this kind of trap? Is because the fact that acoustical phonons dominate the total scattering rate is due to the fact that populations of acoustical phonons grow very strongly with temperature. But the rate of energy loss, as opposed to total scattering rate, is not the sum of emission and absorption probabilities. It is a difference between emission and absorption times the phonon energy. And this is why these additional populations of acoustical phonons due to temperature, they cancel out of the total scattering rate. We have already, and this leads actually to very different temperature dependencies of total scattering rate and of energy loss rate. This we already studied it for the case of gallium arsenide, in which we studied it both, Professor Tanimura has studied it experimentally and we did the calculation. Indeed, energy scattering rate has very different temperature dependence from the total scattering rate. Here we are just showing the results for silicon. It is the same. Of course, the total scattering rate grows with temperature, as it should be, as it's obvious. Mostly it is due to acoustical phonons. And in the case of energy loss rate, there is almost no temperature dependence at all. So with this, I would like to go to the second part of my talk, which is about photoexcited electron relaxation in indium selenide. This is a work which has been done in my laboratory, the Laboratoire des Silices de Radier, in collaboration with two other laboratories from the plateau of Saclay. And indium selenide is a lead material, which is interesting because it has some potential optoelectronic applications. It has very interesting band structure with very deep and very narrow gamma valley and no second conduction band minima up to 0.7 eV. And because of this, the situation with electron-phonon coupling will be very different from silicon or gallium arsenide or germanium. In the case of indium selenide, if electrons are excited at energies below 0.7 eV, then there will be no intervalley scattering. So everything which I just told you does not apply. And the both initial relaxation and the energy loss rate will be dominated by Froelich coupling, so by coupling to polar optical phonons. And so this the experiments were also ARPES experiments, and we calculated the energy loss rate with Vogel model and ab initio parameters. It almost does not depend on the excess energy because the phase space for polar contribution doesn't really depend on the phase space. It's almost a constant, and this constant was found to be in good agreement with experiment. Then later on, this work has been continued recently. And this is the new results in which the relaxation of photoexcited electrons in indium selenide was studied in presence of quasi-two-dimensional electron gas. The quasi-two-dimensional electron gas was created by cesium deposition on indium selenide surface. And so the relaxation of electrons was studied as a function of this cesium deposition. So in this case, one has to be careful to distinguish between two types of electrons. You have the electrons which have been there because of cesium deposition. It's the 2D electron gas. You see that in the case of strong deposition, it's really, you see this dispersion of this 2D gas. And then there are, on top of it, there are photoexcited electrons. If there is very few electrons in the electron gas, then we can clearly distinguish between the two. So here you see the photoexcited electrons, and the other, and here you can see the 2D electron gas. And the population of photoexcited electrons is not thermalized. In the opposite case, when there are very many electrons in the because of cesium deposition, there is fast thermalization, and you cannot really distinguish between the photoexcited electrons and the 2D gas. And so the cooling rate, so the rate of transfer of energy from electrons to phonons, was studied as a function of Fermi level of this 2D gas, so as a function of cesium deposition. And of course, one expects this cooling rate to go down, provided that it is due to Froelich scattering, to scattering with polar optical phonons. We understand that it is going to be screened. And this is indeed the case. However, some of this cooling still stays even at very high level of doping. So the modeling which we have done was a rather simple one. We did, we described the energy loss rate with Froelich scattering in 3D case. And then we applied 3D Fermi screening, Thomas Fermi screening. And also as a toy model, we used a completely 2D case. We applied the model of Thibault Soyer from this paper to describe 2D Froelich coupling. And then the 2D screening was, the formula was taken from this work by Stern. And so the results are here, and you see that it is a 3D modelization which allows to explain the experimental results, which means that even if the electrons are thermalized with 2D gas, there is still a remote coupling with 3D phonons, which allows to have the cooling of electrons. So with this, I'm coming to my conclusion. So I was presenting to you some results about the dynamics of highly excited electrons in semiconductors. So the concept of hot electron ensemble means that in many cases, we don't need to take into account the initial relaxation of the initial position of electrons in the Brillouin zone. It is very fast, and it is often, not always, but often unmeasurable in experiments. And so one has to take into account and calculate the energy relaxation rate. In silicon, energy loss rate is determined by the density of states because it is mostly due to intervalley scattering, and there is no temperature dependence of this energy loss rate. In the case of indium selenide, at excess energies below 0.7 eV, the energy loss rate is determined by the Froelich coupling. And in the case of doped, indium selenide doped on surface, the screening reduces the coupling to polar optical phonons. However, it resembles more to remote coupling to 3D phonon than to a completely 2D phenomenon. And with this, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Jelena, for being exceptionally on time. Actually, too much on time, because I have a lot of time.
Sorry, I was too fast. How?
If there's anything more you wanna say, please go ahead. Otherwise, I can go ahead with the discussions.
Oh yes, it was less than 20 minutes. How come?
Yeah. Well,
so maybe I forgot to say something.
Well, we can have a nice discussion if you like.
Yeah. I think you can go on with discussion because I can. Maybe I can show also the energy dependence of the temperature dependence of the energy relaxation of hot electrons in gallium arsenide, because I skipped it to be faster, but
successfully.
I was too fast, and you see that in that case, there has been an experimental proof that really electron phonon coupling does not always mean strong dependence on temperature. This is what because in silicon there have not been any experimental study on type of temperature dependence, but on gallium arsenide they have been, and it agrees with theory. Yes. So if not, I think we can go on with discussion.
Okay. So we have a couple of questions. The first is from Xavier Gonz. He's asking, will electron-phonon coupling always dominate the total scattering rate? What about the electron-electron scattering?
Well, yes, of course. Well, in all the cases I have shown here, it's not very. For example, in all the experiments of Professor Tanimura, it's always rather small. Electron density, which is supposed to be. In the case of indium selenide, electron-electron scattering participates very actively to thermalize the initially excited electrons, of course. So I would say that electron-electron scattering, of course, it participates if the electron density is high enough. Firstly, to for this isomerization. And then, of course, if the density of carriers is really huge, then you can talk about other things. You can talk about recombination by Auger and things like this. But for this, you have to have really, really high densities of electrons.
Okay. Then there is another question by Mathieu. Can you rationalize further the speed of scattering with the energy conservation? Is that a universal link?
Can you rationalize further the speed of scattering with the energy conservation? Is that a universal link? I don't quite understand.
At the beginning, you showed there were two timescales where you were getting Q scattering very quickly,
yes,
but with no energy loss.
Yes.
And then progressively, you get the photon cascade. Is there something?
It's not. I would not say it's energy conservation. It's really not. In scattering, you have emission and absorption. And mm-hmm. if your goal is to scatter just out of your initial position, then you can do it by emission and by absorption. So actually, it can be rationalized just like this: scattering from initial position to anywhere, you can emit and absorb. If you have 300K, then you can also emit a lot of and absorb a lot of acoustical phonons, which the populations of acoustical phonons, they grow very, very fast with temperatures. If you are considering energy relaxation, then you have emission minus absorption. So of course, with the same ingredients, you're going to get less. It's mathematical. And then you also have to worry about the energy you're going to transfer to phonons. It's time the energy, so it's, if your phonon energy is very, very small, then
you need tons of them.
In terms of energy, electrons will still stay at the same level. So in order to transfer energy to phonons, you really have to emit. And actually what you can do, you can just look at even the total scattering rate. If you look at emission at 0K, actually, and then you multiply it by some effective phonon, then it will tell you about more or less about the energy scattering rate. So instead of emission plus absorption at 300K, you get emission at 0K. And this already gives you the idea that it has to be several times slower.
Okay, so we have one more question by Nick Cox. Do you assume Fermi Dirac distribution for thermalized electrons? And how do you determine Fermi level and temperature?
Yes. Sorry, I stopped sharing that. I think I should share it again. So actually, in the case of last work on indium selenide, yes, we assumed the thermalized electrons. And actually, the Fermi energy was determined experimentally. It was one of the main parameters which allowed us to describe the system, because there was a, this you cannot, the, ah, yes, no. There was the Fermi energy of initial distribution of electrons which were deposited by cesium deposition. And then there was, what was also measured was the electronic temperature of the electrons which were photoexcited. And with these two, it was already possible to describe the Fermi distribution. And it was in this case of these electrons which were thermalized, and with, in the case of excess energies which were really not very far from Fermi energy, it was really important to take into account this Fermi distribution. But in the actually in my previous works with Professor Tanimura on, for example, on silicon and gallium arsenide, we did not take into account any electronic distribution at all. We just assumed it to be delta-like because we did not know, we knew that it was not thermal, that it was highly non-thermal, but we were not able to determine what would be the shape of it. So we did not take it into account. We assumed it to be delta-like. But actually, in this case of indium selenide, I have checked and that if you take a thermal distribution and then you calculate the energy relaxation in the hot energy tail, I don't know if you can see my screen actually.
Yeah, okay, we can see it.
Yes, then it all comes to the same. Taking a Fermi distribution only has a big effect when your excited energy is excess energy is close to the Fermi energy. Otherwise, it's this Fermi distribution is almost zero, and it's the same as taking a delta like, saying just my electron is here and that's all. But in the case of indium selenide, it was really important.
Okay, I have just one curiosity. So precisely about this slide, you mentioned that the 2D screening somehow didn't work very well in your case.
Actually, it worked too well. Yes, but it was a toy model. And toy model means that actually we did not, there are some models which are 2D, but like was discussed today, but takes into account also the fact that the third dimension exists in our space.
Yeah.
For example, there is a work of Valérie Vignard, which is cited of, somehow we decided that, okay, all these models, they go back to 3D model if there's, for example, the slab is sufficiently thick.
Yeah.
So let's take a real 2D world. And this real 2D world with no third dimension at all, the screening works too well. It's not that it doesn't work, but it is very, very strong. And it just reduces this cooling rate to much too small.
Okay.
And the reason is just for this, is just simply dimensionality. Because of course, in both cases, the screening acts on very small Q phonons, but in the case of 3D and 2D integrals, the weight of this small Q phonons is not the same in the integral. It's just simply this.
Right.